We all know that ideal parts do not exist. But what if they seem to exist and are used in cars and consumer electronics? And if they solve the common problem of efficient reverse polarity protection? Enough reasons to look at ideal diodes and check them out. I'm sure you will consider using them in one of your future projects if you only know they exist and how they are used. Gritzy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent bringing you a new episode with fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you'll always sit in the front row. In this video, we will see where we can use them, look at what an ideal diode is and why it's much better than a normal diode, look at their limitations, and of course, we will see where you can use them in your projects. Diodes have many uses, from power electronics to radio frequency applications. The ideal diodes we talk about today are mainly used in two fields. First, reverse polarity protection. Please comment on your most spectacular incident where you unintentionally reversed polarity and what happened. Second, reverse current protection. Inductive loads like motors create reverse currents that can have devastating effects. Or if you want to protect parallel power sources from interfering with each other. How do they work? An ideal diode should pass all current in one direction without any loss and block it in the other direction for any voltage. It should change these two states at an infinite speed. Let's grab an ordinary diode from my drawer, a 1N4148, and see how ideal it is. The multimeter's ohm range shows a resistance of a few megaohms in both directions. Not what we expect. So let's try the diode range of the multimeter. In one direction it shows infinite resistance, in the other it shows 0.6 volts, not 0 ohms as expected. Why is that? Real diodes have a curve like that. At negative voltages the current is completely blocked, at least up to the reverse voltage, which is 75 volts in the case of our diode. In the other direction it behaves similar to a resistor, with one crucial difference. There is always a minimal voltage across the diode, the 0.6 volt our multimeter showed. All three effects are not ideal. But what do they mean for our main application, reverse voltage protection for a device operating at 12 volts? I use a simple setup. My electronic load mimics the device. Powered by my power supply, everything works as expected. The device is powered at 12 volts if I connect the power supply directly to the load. I do not know if my electronic load is protected against reverse polarity. So I do what we always should do in such a situation. I insert my diode. Now I can reverse polarity without a problem. The diode blocks the reverse current and the voltage across the load stays at 0 volts. An inexpensive and effective protection. Not so fast. Let's see what happens in the good case. The power supply offers 12 volts and the load only gets 11.4 volts. So let's measure the voltage across the diode. If I start to draw a current, the voltage across the diode increases and the voltage at the load drops even more. Our device may even stop because of undervoltage. But unfortunately, this is only half of the problem. Energy does not disappear, so the lost power has to be dissipated. The diode heats up and eventually is killed and stops conducting. So it also acts as a fuse. You're right. A 1N4148 is definitely not a suitable diode for this purpose. Let's replace it with a beefy one, an SR5100. Now the voltage drop without current is much smaller, less than 0.3 volts. And at 5 amps, it is 0.7 volts. Not bad. Still, The small diode has to dissipate 4 watts, and it gets hot. The SR5100 has a forward voltage of only 0.3 volts because it is a Schottky diode, by the way. Can we do better? Yes, we can use a bigger diode mounted on a heatsink. That is what we did until recently. But now we have a better solution, the ideal diode. It looks very different. Let's try it and replace the Schottky diode. The voltage without current draw is 0.3 volts. Nothing to write home about. But fortunately, as soon as I draw 10 milliamps, the voltage drops to zero. At 5 amps, it is only around 0.01 volts, which results in a power dissipation of only 50 milliwatt. Nearly ideal, I would say. This small power loss does not increase its temperature. That's why it's rated up to 40 Chinese amps. How is this done? The PCB contains only 3 parts, a beefy MOSFET, an IC, and a capacitor. This simple design is possible because of specialized chips. Obviously, the manufacturer of this PCB does not want us to know which IC he used. With a multimeter, I found that pin 4 is connected to in and pin 8 to out. I asked ChatGPT with this bit of knowledge, and its answer was it is an LM74670. Because the manufacturer did not do a good job scratching the marking, I switched to the Sherlock Holmes mode and found that the last 2 letters of the official marking are SK. A second search found the right IC, the LM74610Q1. So here is the completed diagram. MOSFETs behave like resistors, which can be switched from an infinite resistance when off to a few milliohms when on. And a resistor has no threshold voltage. If we could determine when to switch the MOSFET on and off, its behavior would be very close to an ideal diode. This is the task of the IC. It has a logic to determine when to switch the MOSFET on and off. Because our MOSFET needs around 4 volts between the gate and the source to properly switch on, the IC also includes a charge pump to create this higher voltage. 2 things are unique with this chip. First, it does not need a ground reference. And second, it starts to work at only 0.5 volts. So it can be used as a direct replacement of our Schottky diode for reverse polarity protection. Where are these parts less than ideal? According to the datasheet, this chip takes 2 microseconds to switch on or off, not 8 nanoseconds as the 1N4148. Also, it only supports 42 volts reverse voltage and costs much more than a single Schottky diode. But if you add the needed heatsink to the price of a 40 amps diode, pricing becomes similar. And later we will find a less expensive variant if we need less current. Here I have a second PCB for the same purpose. It uses the LTC4357 chip. This chip needs a ground reference and only starts to work at around 9 volts. Its losses at 5 amps is also higher, 200 milliwatts. But it is suitable for up to 80 volts. And if you search AliExpress, you find many more. Just do not buy variants without ICs. They use a simple design and usually do not work very well. So standard or Schottky diodes are the right choice for use cases other than reverse polarity or reverse current protection. What are typical use cases in your projects? As shown before, reverse voltage protection should be included in all projects with an external power plug because you never know what the user does and if it uses the correct power supply. If you do not need high currents or voltages, you could go for an LM73100 with integrated MOSFETs. These are tiny and cheap chips and do not need an external transistor. They even offer under and over voltage and high current protection. A good choice if your devices use a barrel connector. Another application is when you have two power sources to power a device or charge a battery. An example, in our remote station, an existing battery-operated device runs off a solar-charged 12-volt battery. Because I added a bigger solar panel to the barrack, I wanted the bigger battery to charge the small one in case its solar is insufficient. But I did not want to do the reverse. I tried a Schottky diode and it did not work because of its voltage loss. You can imagine many more such scenarios. What did we learn today? Nearly ideal diodes exist, but only for narrow use cases. They solve two problems of real diodes: voltage drop and heat dissipation. They are widely used and ICs from different manufacturers are available. Most ICs are used in combination with beefy MOSFETs, but for low power applications you get small and inexpensive chips. Typical use cases in your projects are reverse polarity protection and reverse current protection. You can even build full bridge rectifiers with them. That was all for today. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. If you found this video useful or interesting, please support the channel. Thanks for watching and see you in the following video. Bye!